Quantum computers, they're amazing. They look like giant copper squid and take up entire warehouses and require massive amounts of cryogenic cooling. That is until now, because a company called psiquantum thinks they have a novel approach that can change all that. Instead of using electrons like most quantum computers, they use the photons in light. And it turns out by repurposing integrated photonic technology, originally developed for telecom and networking, they believe they're about to level up quantum computers in a major way. So how exactly does it work? And what even are quantum computers? And why does it matter? Let's figure this out together. I'm Ricky, and this is 2-Bit Vinci. This video is sponsored by Aduro Clean Technologies. It's tempting to think that one day our computers and smartphones will be quantum computers, but that's probably not the case. Classical computers are like the automobile, and each year, cars get better. We went from carburetors to fuel injection in a series of constant improvements. Classical computers are the same. We keep shrinking the transistor size and getting more and more performance. But quantum computers are airplanes. Do both cars and planes move people around? Yes, but you're not going to take a plane 10 miles to work, and you're not going to take a car on a vacation around the world. They do similar things, compute. But when and where we use them are entirely different. Digital computers work with ones and zeros called bits, like this. Check this out. This is what you guys see every week. And for all the people who ask if I'm painting on my beard, no, I'm not. So if we keep scrolling though, you'll notice that this video, this picture, is a series of pixels. And if I pull up the digital color meter, you can actually see what the RGB values of each and every pixel are. So that means that if I wanted to represent this video, I could break it down pixel by pixel and using 8 bits for red, 8 bits for green, and 8 bits for blue, an 8-bit image, 24 bits in total, I could represent each pixel and a series of ones and zeros in binary, and I can make a video. So by arranging information into long series of bits, you can make videos, music, movies, video games, and everything else that we love. But quantum computers work on the principle of quantum mechanics and use quantum bits or qubits. At the very small scale of quantum, things get weird and unintuitive. Newtonian physics explained why this pen follows a parabolic path when thrown, or why planes fly. And just because we've furthered our understanding of quantum physics doesn't mean that classical Newtonian physics goes out the door. It's the perfect analogy for digital computers and quantum computers. They are different tools in our toolkit of understanding. Remember Schrodinger's cat, where if you put a cat in a box and seal it, it would, for all intents and purposes, be both dead and alive at the same time until the moment you open the box? Well, it's the same thing with electrons orbiting the nucleus of an atom. We can't really know where it is, and the photons in light that we'd need to observe it would actually interact and change the result. This is all to say that while our digital computers work on certainty, a switch being flipped either on or off, quantum computers thrive in the uncertainty. A qubit exists in a spectrum of likelihood of being either on or off. And when it comes to modeling the tiny molecules in our body for drug research, quantum computers will one day dominate. It's the same for better research into nuclear fusion or modeling our world, because in all those cases, they're governed by quantum physics, and the strengths of quantum computers give it a home court advantage. Right, so what about this new breakthrough then? You see this bowl of ice? It's really cold. It's 0 degrees Celsius to be exact. And it's tempting to think that 0 degrees Celsius is cold, but on the absolute scale of Kelvin, this is actually 273.15 degrees, which means that this ice cube is actually closer to its boiling point than it is to absolute zero. I bring this up because of quantum mechanics. To make quantum computers meaningful, we need to cool our detectors down to around 15 millikelvin, which is colder than even outer space. It's what gives our quantum computers that beautiful copper octopus look. Some technologies like quantum computers just have such a wide range of potential applications, much like our sponsor this week, Aduro Clean Technologies. We did an entire deep dive video on Aduro that you have to check out, because their game-changing tech may finally give us a closed-loop system of recycling plastics and finally a competitor to pyrolysis, the traditional approach. For reference, their approach has an amazing 95% yield on polypropylene. And now their process can handle an even wider range of contaminants found in plastic. Aduro also successfully demonstrated their technology in deconstructing cross-linked polymers, a critical component in rubber tires, which is huge because, like plastics, the same qualities that make rubber so useful also make it a huge challenge to recycle. When last we met with Aduro, they showed us their test scale continuous flow process and started fundraising to scale to the next level. So how is that going? Really well. Setting out to raise $2.5 million, they actually closed on $3.5 million and are poised for the future and ready for the next step of key customer engagements to bring their cutting-edge tech closer to market. If you're interested in learning more about Aduro and their pioneering work, check out our in-depth video on their technology and see how they're transforming the recycling industry. I'm thrilled to partner with a company that's not only pushing the boundaries of technology, but also making a real impact in the fight against waste and pollution. Their commitment to sustainability and innovation aligns perfectly with the values that we promote on this channel. So huge thanks to Aduro and you. Now back to the show. So then even this ice actually has a lot of energy and the molecules are vibrating and moving around. And if your detectors for a quantum computer had this much energy, there'd be so much noise it wouldn't be able to detect what's actually happening with the qubits. But this is where the breakthrough comes in. Psiquantum is actually building quantum computers that look more like our fabricated silicon chips that we see on our computers today using photonics. By doing this, they don't have to have massive cooling rooms. All they have to do is cool the detector. This is a field called photonic quantum computing, and it offers several advantages. Scalability, for one. Photonic qubits are easier to scale than other qubit types. They can be manufactured using existing semiconductor fabrication techniques, allowing for hundreds of qubits to be on a single chip. The next key benefit is room temperature operation. Unlike superconducting or trapped ion qubits, photonic qubits don't require extreme cooling, simplifying the infrastructure and reducing cost. And finally, there's error correction. PsiQuantum's architecture incorporates a robust error correction scheme based on the GKP code, designed specifically for photonic systems. But how exactly are they turning photons into qubits? This took a little while to figure out, but here's what I found out. You need three things to make a qubit. One, you need a system that can be in a state of one or zero, but also in any superposition of those states. Two, you also need to be able to create entangled qubits. And three, you need qubits to interact with each other through quantum interference to enable quantum algorithms to enhance corrections with constructive interference, like we mentioned before, and suppress wrong answers with destructive interference. Light, believe it or not, actually ticks all those boxes. In the simplest case, you can make photonic qubit states by being there or not there, one or zero. And you can do this by splitting a beam of light into two separate paths. If the light photon is there, you have a one. If it's not there, then you have a zero. The crazy thing about this is that even a single photon that hits a beam splitter will split between the two paths and be in both paths at the same time. And this is what PsiQuantum uses, path-encoded photonic qubits. Light can have any polarization in between vertical and horizontal, or even have all polarizations at once like sunlight, which is the same as saying it's not polarized at all. So photons can have a superposition of polarization states as well. The other property of photons that make them work as qubits is that you can drive a photon through a nonlinear crystal and it'll split into two longer energy photons that are entangled. Also, since light is made up of electromagnetic waves, photons can interfere with one another when those waves interact. So you can create entangled photons with superpositions of zero and one states, and photons show quantum interference. Those are the hallmarks of a qubit. The best thing about photonic qubits is that unlike trapped ion or superconducting circuit qubits, you can make qubits out of photons at room temperature, like in this. However, you also need to detect those single photons, and the detector needs to be chilled down to about 4 Kelvin so that its own noise doesn't drown out the single photon hitting it. But the very best thing about the approach is its scalability. PsiQuantum's design involves modular quantum computing units that can be interconnected to create larger, more powerful systems. PsiQuantum is not just focused on building the biggest or most complex quantum computer. They aim to deliver a machine that you can solve real-world problems in areas like drug discovery, material science, and finance. Their approach emphasizes practical applications and delivering real value to users. Now, while challenges remain, their innovative approach offers a promising path forward to overcoming the key drawbacks of quantum computing and ushering a new era of technological advancement. PsiQuantum's chips are a marvel of miniaturization. Imagine a bustling factory where particles of light are created, guided through intricate pathways, and precisely measured. This entire factory fits on a single tiny chip smaller than your fingernail. This is a huge departure from traditional quantum setups, which often look like something out of a sci-fi movie. Tables full of lasers, mirrors, and bulky detectors. PsiQuantum's approach is sleek, efficient, and most importantly, scalable. But overall, the best part about this story is that they have a clear deadline for the first commercial utility scale quantum computer in the world. That's something no one else can claim. PsiQuantum signed a deal with the Australian government to build the first quantum computer in Brisbane no later than 2029. The computer will cost almost $400 million and will be pretty similar to a modern data center. And who's helping them build it? None other than Global Foundries, the third largest chip manufacturer in the world. And that's the secret to scaling this technology to a meaningful capacity. Global Foundries might not be a household name, but they're a major player in the chip industry. They've been overshadowed by the giants like TSMC, but quantum computing could be their chance to leapfrog the competition. But let's be real, quantum computers are not about to replace your laptop, but they will revolutionize industries in ways we're just starting to grasp. But of course, there's still a long way to go. The commercial scale plant is 2029. The photonic detectors still need to be cryogenically cooled. How are we going to do that reliably? There's still a lot of questions, but this photonic approach is one of the first times that quantum computers have gone from the lab to something that we could actually see in products around the world. The key will be if they can figure out the error correction, because it's still a major hurdle. Until you sort that out and you can actually have scalable performance that doesn't have to increase the scale of the error correction, it's going to be a bit of a challenge. And of course, the big one is going to be cost. The first commercially viable quantum computers will cost hundreds of millions of dollars to build. But of course, remember that the very first computers were massive data farms in the middle of the Pentagon as well, and they cost millions of dollars. And now you can get a phone for $50 on Amazon, right? So technology has a way of coming downstream. But what do you think? Do you think a technology and a breakthrough like this could have meaningful impacts to consumer products, or is it just for AI and data centers and other things like that? Sound off in the comments below. And while you're at it, if you want to learn more about the impact of AI and its energies, check out this video next. And until next week, I'm Rick Da Vinci. Thank you so much for watching.